Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air, but first, the daily contemplation. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guide of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They are training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation, the joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you.
Good morning, friends. Today I will talk a little bit about how to elevate the mind out of suppression, how to cure depression. Because one of my friends, he sent me a question and told me he was depressed and what to do about it from a Buddhist point of view. But before we start with the usual intro, which we always start with before any Dhamma speech.
Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened is the blessed Buddha.
There's two sides of being depressed. I think everybody has tried it. It has different degrees. It's kind of like the low mind goes up and down in mood. And sometimes you're elated, sometimes you're suppressed or depressed, and then you feel what we call moody blue, or in a bad mood, having no joy, and it's usually having a lousy feeling, a painful feeling in mind. And if it doesn't kind of like evaporate, and you're, one can be unable to come out of it, and it takes a long time, maybe months, then it can be leading to even suicide. So it's something that can make people kill themselves. In the pathological condition, They can also attain a state of stupor, where, as you can see in psychiatric departments, people who are so depressed that they cannot move. They basically just sit in a chair all day. So also the body is affected. The motoric movement is dampened down, they cannot move. And they are completely stoned inside their mind and feeling a very, very painful feeling about themselves. So it can be very grave. In all cases, so, the Buddhist treatment is the same. But before we go to the treatment, the cure, I'd just like to say a few words about prevention, because this has to do with the cause of one being depressed, which one usually does not recognize. The cause can be manifold, but basically one has done something wrong. There's a karmic side of the cause. There can also be other causes, biological causes, hormonal causes, not too much light, bad weather, war in the country, conflict in the family, feeling uneasy at job, and so on. External things. But basically, it's the mind that reacts on these external things. So if you elevate the mind, it can kind of like cope with these external things without being depressed. And that's, of course, an advantage. So basically, if one has done something wrong, that is, one has killed somebody or something, or harmed someone or something, any kind of life form, any kind of consciousness, then one cannot feel happy. The same is when if one has told a lie, or if one has stolen something, or cheated something, or one have had sex with an illegitimate partner, one's friend's wife, or somebody else one shouldn't have sex with. Or one have taken drugs in a situation, for example, when one has worked as a doctor or as a dentist or as a lawyer, one has taken drugs, or while driving, for example, one has then thereby harmed other people either directly or indirectly, or put them at risk of harm at least. And that's wrong. Then what happens later down the road is then one get bad consciousness, of course. One get regrets and remorse, and then one cannot feel joy because of this regret and remorse. So regret and remorse, which is a consequence of bad morality, exclude happiness, exclude feeling joy, exclude being glad. And because of that, when there's no joy, when there's no gladness, when there's no happiness for a prolonged amount of time, only these speculations about why did I do that, and was this wrong or not, and it was wrong, and how can I repair, and I'm feeling too much ashamed to repair, to admit my lie, or to admit that I've stolen something or done something wrong. Then mind is locked in a kind of situation where it cannot come out because of this erroneous behavior in the past. This is causing minds a lot of pain, a lot of suffering, which we, in modern terms, notify or designate as depression. So the prevention is, of course, not to do something wrong, not to steal anything, or make fraud, or make wrong notes about money issues or any kind of valuable, not misappropriate any kind of value, not pretending anything, not lying, and not killing anything or harming anybody in any possible way, neither directly or indirectly. Because of this, then of course one attain the state we call innocence. When one is innocent, one has done no wrong, one have no need to hide anything on one's back, then one naturally and logically actually feels joy. Huh? It's like an innocent child. An innocent child plays around and feels a lot of joy. Why? Because they've not done anything wrong. They've not done anything wrong. And that's why they feel joy. The cure then, what when one is depressed and it's too late to prevent it, then the cure is a very specific cure, is what we call metta meditation. Metta means friend. So it's basically meditation on friendliness or on goodwill. The next expert, the next Buddha, actually is called Maitreya, because he's very, very friendly. He also was very, very friendly for a long time of period when he was a bodhisattva, wherever he is now, he's also very friendly. He teaches also friendliness exactly as I do today. So metta means friend, metta means friendliness or goodwill, and it's meditation at exactly that aspect that cures or takes the mind out of suppression. It elevates the mind. Before I start with the systematic method, I just like to present to you some citations of the Buddha, which is important for every Buddhist to know what the Buddha said about a particular thing. Because I'm not enlightened, and most other teachers today, if not all other teachers today, are not enlightened. And there's a very, very large difference in eloquence and in clarity and perspicuity of expression, economy of expression also, from a non-enlightened person to an enlightened person. And in the Samasambuddhas, Buddhas, the perfectly self-enlightened Buddhas, you have an absolute maximum of knowledge, of understanding, and also of ability and eloquence to express a given aspect exactly as it is. So this is important. One can use other teachers, of course, if there's no other one can use other teachers, but it's important to go back to the text and see with whatever aspect, whatever problem there is, whatever conflict or dispute there might be about a given situation, one goes back to the text, the Tipitaka text, and look up what have the Buddha actually said about this issue. And then one will find out that he has said something that is often very well spoken, very exact, to the point, and that will resolve the issue unambiguously. So I like to make some citation first. How does a monk with a mind filled with embracing kindness pervade one direction? Yet just as the sight of a dear and agreeable childhood friend, one may feel kindness. Exactly so does he pervade all living beings with this kind friendliness. So what he's saying is that the same kindness or gentleness or a good feeling, a good vibe that you feel when you see a good friend of yours, or when you see your own child, or somebody you love and feel very dear feelings for, then you take this feeling, this very same feeling, and copy it and pervade it in all directions. First in this direction, then in right direction, then in the back, and then to this side, to the left, and below, and as above. So one beam it in all directions, the same feeling. One uses the same scabbard or technique as one copy. And therefore, it's important to note that awareness of this feeling, exact taste of this feeling when you recognize a good friend of yours, a good friend, either when you think about him or her, or when you see this, then there's a good feeling, a smile on your face, and you want to embrace the other one, the other person, your friend. The same feeling one should copycat to all beings, basically. That's what he's saying. The mirror effect of that is, of course, as you see, I have difficulties not smiling, just thinking about it, because it brings actually a smile on your face instantly. And that means, of course, that the depression has gone. This doesn't mean that your depression will not come back as soon as you don't repeat this aspect. But if you repeat it daily, on a daily basis, for 2 or 3 months, I would say, for something in between 20 and 45 minutes daily, almost all lighter depressions, even up to medium depressions, that is people who are not in a hospital, who are running around freely out and who doesn't take any strong medication against that depression, these kinds of depressions, they can be elevated and cured by this as long as it's repeated. But one has to make an effort, of course. One has to make an effort oneself. There's no kind of like quick cure. And the happy pills won't cure you either. That's proven now. It has almost no effect on light to middle severe depressions. Happy pills, Prozac and all that junk. It has no effect. It has slight effect on severe depression, but not light and medium depression. For a further citation, may all beings live in happiness and peace, filled with joy and delight. Sutta Nibbana 135. So instead of saying to oneself. Oh, I'm in so bad speed, so bad mood, and feeling so much pity for myself. I'm gonna kill myself. I just love my girlfriend or boyfriend, or I lost all my money. It's so, so bad for me. Then one feels it, turns it around, kind of use the mirror, we say. It's not to see yourself, actually, it's for the opposite purpose. It you use the mirror to reflect one's own state out into reality, which then is reflected back to you. Reality works as a mirror, the intention of it. So if you reflect joy and goodwill and happiness to all other beings, this will come back to yourself karmically. So you use this mirror of reality skillfully. By sending the right thing out, you're getting the right thing back. By sending self-pity out, you does not get pity back, you get bad spirit back, because self-pity has this egoistic aspect that, oh, I'm feeling pity for myself. It's this self that is not there. Huh? If you feel pity for others, then it's very advantageous. This way, kusala. But if you feel pity for yourself, it is very disadvantageous, because it has this egoistic aspect embedded in self-pity. If you feel pity for all other beings, and there are, in all cases, almost all cases of any kind of suffering, any kind of frustration, you can find other beings that are suffering much more than you. You are a human being, huh? The animals, they suffer much more. And there are also many other human beings that usually suffer more than oneself in any given time moment. And it's more skillful from a Buddhist point of view to point one's pityness towards them instead of oneself. This was elevate one's own mind, refine one's own mind. While you're feeling pity for yourself, you're actually just being even more egoistic. You are reinforcing the egoistic pattern that later on will make you say, because this is so bad for myself, I'm allowed to punish someone else. Because you feel pity so much for yourself, I'm allowed to punish someone else if they threaten to do something towards me. And even if they don't do something towards me, I can maybe even kill them or harm them, or I can protect myself using weapons and so on. So this self-pity is not innocent in any kind of that word at all. May all creatures, all breathing things, all beings one and all, without exception, experience good fortune only. May they not fall into any harm. Anguttara Nikaya. True, number 72. Will goodwill for the entire cosmos cultivate a limitless heart and mind, beaming above, below, and all around, unobstructed, without trace of hostility. This is it. The Buddha on the universality of friendliness in Pali. Sabba satta bhavantu sukhi tatta. May all beings become thus happy. It's a very famous citation. I'm a friend of all with 2 feet. I'm a friend with all with 4 feet. I'm a friend of the many-footed, the insects. I'm a friend of those with no feet, the snakes. Therefore, they don't harm me. And there you see, this has another aspect of not only protection regarding your own mind mood, that it protects you from depression. It also protects you, this goodwill, beaming this out in all directions to all beings, completely indiscriminately, also protect you that they will not feel any hostility towards you. It's very, very difficult for them to feel hostile towards one who basically feels that he's their best friend and who's very good to them. So they don't attack him. They don't cause him any problem. One thinks, may these beings be free from animosity, free from oppression, free from trouble, and may they look after themselves with ease. Anguttara Nikaya, number 5. The absence of hate, hating, hatred, the absence of anger and any malignity, and the presence of love, friendly kindness, gentle disposition, tender care, forbearance, genuine considerateness, seeking the general good for all, compassion, this is the root of all good behavior. It's from the Dharmasangani. As I am, so are others. As others are, so am I. Having thus identified self with others, never harm anyone, nor have anyone abused. So thereby one can say, if one loves oneself, and one knows the other ones also are exactly oneself, and they also love themselves, and they also want to stay at ease and in happiness, one should not harm them in any way. This protects them, this also protects one. On the physical level, their life is preserved, and their life conditions are preserved, but it's also are preserving one's own ability to feel joy, gladness, innocence, happiness, and ease in life, and so also for the other beings. So it's a win-win situation for oneself and for others. The Buddha again. I found no one whom I love better than myself. Exactly so do all other beings also love themselves most dearly. Thus, wishing well to all, one should harm no one or harm anyone. Sutta Nipaccha 3, number 8. Among tigers, lions, leopards, and bears, I lived in the jungle, just like here. No one was frightened of me, nor did I fear anyone. Uplifted by such universal friendliness, I enjoyed the forest, finding great solace in such sweetly silenced solitude. Suvarnasama Jataka 540. Will good food for the entire cosmos cultivate a limitless heart and mind, being above, below, all around, unobstructed, without trace of ill will or enmity. The infinite aspect of goodwill is important. Why so? Because if you feel that you are only goodwill towards, you're only friendly towards those, but not towards those, they're kind of like conditions or limits to your goodwill, the mirror effect of your goodwill will also be limited. So one has to make this limitless, and as I say, for the entire cosmos, for all beings in the entire cosmos. And this will be reflected in the systematic method I'll put forth in a minute. Train yourself in doing good that lasts and brings happiness. Cultivate generosity, the life of peace, and a mind of infinite universal love. So basically, you try to love everybody. This is not easy, but it's possible, and therefore one should do it. When one succeeds in loving everybody, and this of course is something that oscillates like everything else inside mind from time to time, from second to second. But when one succeeds in loving everybody, doing this training, then it's a very, very good feeling. It's a very, very good feeling. It elevates mind, and this is because the mirror effect of this universal, cosmic, infinite, endless, boundless, unconditional friendliness, love, goodwill, this is being backed by this enormous mirror to yourself. And thereby the effect, if the cause is infinite, the effect back to yourself, the karmic effect, is also infinite. So a little bit, making a little, being a little friendly is good. Some more is better. Much is even better. And much, much more is even better. But infinite is best. As I said, if the cause, the goodwill you're beaming out, is infinite, the karmic effect of joy, of elevation, of feeling protected from all sides, fearless from all sides, is also infinite. So it's a question of being more effective by making it infinite. One cannot do it at once. It's not so easy, but one can do it over training. I think most beings can do it, or can reach kind of like infiniteness or infinitude in friendliness over something in between 3 months and a year. It's realistic, probably, that they can feel infinite friendliness towards all beings while on the pillow, and also infinite friendliness to all beings on a stable condition where they are out in society and acting. This gives a mental release. About this mental release, which is called metta, seto, or ceto, vimutti. Metta, friendliness, ceto, mind, vimutti, release, liberation. So it's a mental release or setting free of the mind using friendliness as a tool to lock up the mind. Regarding this self-pity, the egoistic aspect also, when one has this notion of an ego, one puts oneself in a prison, actually. It's an inner prison, an ego prison. And it has to be locked up, this ego prison, so what can come out of this ego prison, this mental ego prison, which is taking one's freedom away as a conscious being, in much more effectively than any physical prison, any Alcatraz could do it. Because this can take away your physical freedom, but it cannot take away your mental freedom. But your mental freedom is more important than the physical, actually. So this ego has to be taken out. And the goodwill is typically something one feels for other beings, or all beings, including oneself. So there's no ego there. There's no ego there. There's only this aspect of goodwill, of harmlessness, of love, of friendliness. This is blazing. This is bright. It's going beyond anything else, actually. Mental release by all embracing friendliness is practiced in five ways. With unspecified extension, may all beings be free from anger, anxiety, and frustration, and may they pass their life in happiness. May all living beings, all creatures, all individuals, all those included in existence, be free from anger, anxiety, frustration, and may they be happy. Parasangani. And how does a bhikkhu abide with his mind imbued with friendliness, extending over all? Just as he would feel friendliness, and so seeing a deeply favored person, exactly does he feel towards all beings in all directions. Again, he copycats this feeling he has from his most favorite person, his friend, his dear child, his dear wife, or spouse, or companion, or whoever it may be, teacher. And then he extends this to all beings in all directions, in front, to the right side, back, to the left side, above as below, in all directions. Again, the Blessed Buddha once said, bhikkhus and friends, there are these four infinite mental states. The bhikkhu pervades all being with all embracing friendliness. The bhikkhu encompasses all creatures with universal and endless pity. The bhikkhu permeates all individuals with infinite and mutual joy, joy over their success. And the bhikkhu suffuses all living mortals with unlimited equanimity. So this we call the Appamana Brahma Vihara, the dwelling Vihara, Brahma, best, Appamana, infinite, the infinitely best way to live or to abide or to dwell, mentally speaking. It's this Brahma Viharas, and there are four of them. The first one is friendliness, the second is pity, the third is mutual joy, and the fourth is equanimity. And we are talking specifically about the first today. First in one direction, then in the second, then in the third, finally in the fourth. Above, below, all around, in every location, unifying himself with all beings. He pervades the entire universe with a kind and all-embracing friendliness, altruistic joy, and with an all-encompassing, imperturbable equanimity. Fully utilizing a refined mind, made great, vast, profound, infinite, immeasurable, and released from all hate, anger, irritation, opposition, and stubbornness. Dikha Nikaya number 33. So he uses a mind, this tool, the mind, that is made waste, it's called. David Lynch, filmmaker, made Twin Peaks and other things. He said for a short time ago, he was asked about, he did meditation, and what was the effect of the meditation on his creative powers as a filmmaker. And then he said very shortly, and I like to repeat that if you have a golf ball sized mind, then when you read a book, you'll get a golf ball sized understanding of that book. And when you look out of the world and you experience the world and interact with the world, this will be a golf ball sized experience of that world and a golf ball sized interaction with that world. including the other beings that are in that world. That will be golf ball sized. However, if you have a mind that is larger, let's say like a tennis ball or like a football or like a bath ball or like a very large ball, like a house or like an airport. If you have an airport sized mind, you will have an airport sized understanding of a book when you reach a book, and an airport sized experience of the world, and an airport sized interaction with the world, including all the beings that are in that world. Of course, if you make the mind infinite, it goes the same. You'll have an infinite understanding of the book, experience of the world, and interaction with that world. Because you have made the mind waste. You have expanded the mind. And therefore, this situation, the method that we go through in a minute or two, it has this purpose of gradually expanding mind. Train this by expanding the object that you are feeling goodwill towards, first towards one person, then two person, then three person, and then in the end all beings. Gradually, slowly, step for step, this expansion process until the object is infinite. Thereby, when the object that the mind thinks about, feel goodwill about, this mind is also infinite, because the mind is basically the same as the entity or process that is grasping the object. So if a mind has to grasp an infinite object, the mind itself also has to be infinite. That's logic, huh? Some short words about the ethics. The Buddha said, bhikkhus, whatever kinds of worldly merit there are, whatever do you good, whatever karma effect you can do, these are all not worth 1/16th part of the release of mind by universal friendliness. In shining, glowing, and beaming radiance, in invisible yet shielding protection, such release of mind by universal friendliness far excels and surpasses them all. This, whatever good you do, for example, if you do as much good as Bill and Melinda Gates do with their foundation, and they do a lot of good, actually. Giving hospitals, vaccine research, they're giving more than the United Nations and all other nations on the world, summed up together, they have given to vaccine research and to making vaccines available to people who cannot afford it. So they're doing a lot of good. And even if you build 1 billion hospitals or elder care homes or whatever, what the Buddha is saying is this is not worth, karmically speaking, the effect of it is not worth 1/16th part or fraction of a mind that is released by friendliness. Not 1/16th. That's important. So is what we are trying here to achieve here today is not a small thing. It's important. It's a big thing. It's one can take one up further than any worldly merit can do. It can take one to the Brahma level. It can take one out of the sensual level. It can take one to up to level 16 on the 31 levels of existence. We are now on level 5, the human level. There on level 16, you cannot go by giving gifts, physical gifts. You have to do meditation. Metta meditation is one method. There are other methods also. So now we start with a systematic method. Note that you start with the small and then you extend it to the big, so that it's the expansion of the object and thereby also the expansion of the mind. And you feel that very much in your sense. If one feels that one cannot expand any further, then one should stop for a moment there and then reinforce that by repeat the extension of that object, for example, all beings in this city. You can start, for example, may all these beings in this house be happy. Or start with yourself, may I be happy. May all beings in this house be happy. May all beings in this city be happy. May all beings in this country be happy. May all beings in this continent be happy. May all beings on this planet be happy. May all beings in this solar system be happy. May all beings in this galaxy be happy. May all beings in this galaxy cluster be happy. May all beings in this entire cosmos be happy. If you're at one level there, one of these levels, when you have tried to expand your goodwill, feel now it's getting kind of like little thin in the edges. It's not really saturated. You cannot really cover the object with this goodwill, like you cover a drum with a skin. Then one backs up one level and stays there until it's saturated there. Then one can go to the next level. So one doesn't do it as quick as I do. One notes the feeling, the taste of it, whether it's complete or not. Usually you feel like there's kind of like holes in it. When it gets too thin, it's like you're stretching out a piece of cloth over an object, and then it doesn't cover. Or there's holes in it, so it doesn't cover because of these holes. Either it not cover this side, or it's not cover that side. If you pull it over, then it doesn't cover the other side. So the same thing also can do be with this feeling of goodwill. Then its mind is still too little, too much golf balls, you can say. So it cannot cover the object. But you can stretch it by practice, by training. And that's what this speech, this Dhamma teaching is about. Begin by extended friendliness towards yourself. May I be free from ill will. May I be free from hostility. May I be free from adversity. May I be happy. May I be free from suffering. May I not be separated from good fortune I have attained, because I'm the owner of my karma and must inherit its results. May the lower level deities, the angels, you can say in Christian terminology, may the deities that are in this house, or may the other beings that are in this house, may they be free from anger. May they be free from hostility. May they be free from adversity. May they be happy. May they be free from suffering. May they not be separated from the good fortune they have attained, because they are owners of their karma and will inherit in its results. Next one can extend this friendliness, this goodwill, this love towards your parents, teachers, relatives, and all friends by this way. May my mother, father, teacher, relatives, and associates be free from anger. May they be free from hostility. May they be free from adversity. May they be happy. May they be free from suffering. May they not be separated from the good fortune they have attained or earned, since they are owners of their karma and will have to experience it. Then extend friendliness to all kinds of living beings. May all sentient beings, all breathing beings, all persons, all individuals, all women, all men, all noble persons, all ordinary persons, all deities, all human beings, all destined for the states of loss, all these beings who are going down one way or another, may all these individualities be free from anger. May they be free from hostility. May they be free from adversity. May they be happy. May they be free from suffering. May they not be separated from the good fortune they have earned, since all beings are the owners of their karma and must experience its results. Finally, extend friendliness in all directions. In the east, to the south, west, north, southeast, southwest, northwest, northeast, below and as above. May all sentient beings, all breathing beings, all persons, all individuals, all females, all males, all noble ones, all ordinary persons, all deities, all human beings, all those destined for the states of loss who are falling because of have done wrong, may they be free from anger. May they be free from hostility. May they be free from bad luck. May they be happy. May they be free from suffering. May they not be separated from the good fortune, the good karma they have earned and attained, because all beings are owners of their karma and will experience its results. There you see, it's the same kind of tool, same kind of verbal device one keeps on repeating with a new object that is gradually bigger than the one before. So gradually, little by little, one expands. You can add your own flavor to this I usually say to people, make this your mantra if they are depressed or suppressed. I can see that some that they feel some suffering, some pain. Is that they, instead of going around looking at themselves with this disadvantageous, detrimental self-pity, then they make it their mantra for inner repetition, always. May all beings be happy. Citation of the Buddha, huh? May all beings be happy. And just keep repeating that in the daily life. This can be done in the bus. This can be done in the train. This can be done in the queue at the post office or at the shop or in the waiting line at the supermarket. And then you will see that instead of feeling, see now I have to laugh, instead of feeling depressed about the situation that one doesn't like, this is a kind of frustrating situation, then because of one repeats this mantra, may all beings be happy, then oneself becomes happy. And one will see then immediately also the reaction about that is also that the immediate surroundings of other beings also standing that queue in that situation, on that train station, or whatever it may be, they also are kind of like elevated by this attitude, this change of attitude one changes oneself. And it puts a smile on one's face. And when you start smiling to the world also smiles to you. The other beings also start smiling because they see one smiling, they have mirror neurons inside, and they say, ah, he's a smiling, then I also can smile. Then they also start smiling. Huh? It's a reflex, a copycat reflex. Okay, let's take the systematic method. It's all on my website. I used this method in the start. I printed it out. Or you can play this video for yourself. Only the soundtrack of it when you meditate. But it's best to memorize it, word for word, and then tell it to oneself. One can make small variations over it. One's personal favorite variations one can put into it. But the general pattern should be just like I'm saying now. Sitting alone in silence, each early morning with closed eyes, one wishes genuinely, with a devoted heart, may I radiate and meet only infinite friendliness, kindness and goodwill. May I and all various beings on the 31 levels of existence develop and find only the genuine and infinite friendliness, kindness, and genuine goodwill. May I and all beings on the sense desire, fine material, and formless plane of existence develop and encounter this fine, endless friendliness, kindness, and goodwill. May I and all beings in the front, to the right, the back, the left, below, and as above, develop and experience this high, boundless friendliness, kindness, and goodwill. May I and all beings in this city, country, and universe always be fully aware and profoundly mindful of this immeasurable friendliness, kindness, and amity. May I and all beings in this city, country, and universe examine all details and subtle aspects of this sublime, never-ending friendliness, kindness, and goodwill. May I and all beings in this country and universe push enthusiastic effort, enraptured joy, tranquility, and attain concentration in this friendliness, illimitable kindness and goodwill. May I and all beings in this city, country and universe dwell in undisturbable and imperturbable balance of limitless friendliness, kindness and goodwill. So here one joins goodwill with seven other characteristics. One joins it with awareness. One is aware of being friendly. One investigates being friendly. One puts energetic, enthusiastic effort into being friendly. One puts the state of being enraptured into being friendly, feeling joy into being friendly. One puts tranquility into being friendly, and one puts equanimity, make it undisturbable, into its friendliness also. Thereby one solidifies the friendliness, one stabilizes the friendliness, so it's more rugged, is more solid, is more persistent in situations where provocations occur, where someone is spitting you in the face, still you can feel friendliness towards him. Because you have joined the friendliness with seven characteristics, mental states, that has fortified, cemented this friendliness. So you cannot be pulled out of it, pulled out of this state. This universal friendliness is called the first endless state, the first Appamana, Brahma Vihara. It gradually reduces all hate, anger, irritation, resentment, opposition, stubbornness, mental rigidity, and any unhappiness, depression, feeling low, moody, blue, joined or associated or linked to these states of mind. Release of mind by universal friendliness, metta, citta vimutti, is more than 16 times more worth than any merit won by whatever worldly gift or gain. We also say there's 11 advantages. This is the Buddha, something the Buddha he said. And it makes it easy to see why it's effective against depression. Because hence why he said, one falls asleep in comfort and in happiness. One wakes up in comfort and happiness. One dreams no evil dreams. One is dear and popular and, among other human beings. One is dear and popular among other non-human beings, that is, animals and devas. And one is protected by the devas, by the divine beings. Fire, poison, and weapons cannot harm one, cannot touch one. One becomes easily concentrated. One gets a serene face, facial expression, which also become kind of like without wrinkles. So one is beautified, physically speaking. One dies without confusion and without panic. And 11, if one cannot attain to any higher level, then one attains a level of the Brahma level at the moment of death. If one is in this state of mind of universal friendliness at the moment of death, then one will be reborn according to that Brahma level in the first jhana, which is the Brahma. They have no feeling of hate or any aversion. Brahma devas, they always stay in this first jhana of friendliness. They are staying in this meditative absorption habitually for their entire life. And because if one can bring the state to this very open friendliness, this complete harmlessness at the moment of death, then one will be reborn among the very same beings that has this mental state. Of course, the mental state you have at the moment of death is conditioned by all the other mental states that you have in your life, and whether you did good or bad. It is easy to imagine that if you kill somebody or kill 1,000 persons, then it would be very difficult to attain this state of mind at the moment of death. Because you are feeling a lot of regret, remorse, panic, anger, confusion, and so on. You cannot concentrate on friendliness, universal friendliness at the moment of death. But if you trained it all your life, or the last 10 years, or the last 3 months even, then it's much more easy, much more likely, much more probable that at the exact moment of death, one will be in this goodwill state of mind. One will die with a smile on one's face. These 11 advantages emerge and remain insofar as goodwill is maintained. So it covers the situation where one actually is in this state of mind. If you start hating somebody, then they don't cover. But as soon as you go back to this friendly state of mind, they still are effective. Enough for today. I just summarize shortly again. The prevention against depression is to not to do anything wrong or bad or evil, because this will go back to you, come back to you as regret and remorse. And secondly, to do something good in the sense of doing specifically metta meditation to cure this depression, to elevate mind out of suppression, is to do expansive up to the infinite level of goodwill, of friendliness, of harmlessness, and wishing well for others. This is the exact opposite of feeling pity for yourself. The exact opposite. Therefore, it has the exact opposite effect. Feeling pity for yourself will only make one even more depressed because of the egoism involved in the self-pity. But being good, feeling goodwill, making good wishes for others, may other beings be happy. May all other beings be happy. In the entire cosmos, in all galaxies, say, there they are, may they be happy. This will make yourself happy because of this mirror effect. Thank you. I also like to say that I hope I thank two donors who have given this new microphone, a Rode Lavalier microphone and a recorder I'm using that you cannot see right now. I can maybe show it here. A sound recorder, a small thing, Tascam DR60. So I'm now recording this sound on another unit than the camera, and I hope it will be a better sound. So thank you to these two donors, and thank you for your attention.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.